thanks for inviting me to give a few words about automatic error analysis of machine translations. So first of all, so some of you know a lot about machine translations, some of maybe not so much, but in general there are a lot of machine translation engines and then a lot of evaluations. And then there are also human evaluations, automatic evaluations, and then of course automatic evaluation is preferred because it's quicker. And there are a bunch of standards automatic evaluation metrics which are already widely spread in the community and are used for years now. And they are good for developers and comparing a new system with old ones and different systems and so on and so on. But then, however, they don't provide any detailed answers. For example, if you want to know, is there any particular strength or weakness of my system? Or for example, if I do some modification of the system, what I exactly improved? Or for example, if there are several systems, then overall some system may perform very badly, but it still can make some strengths in comparison, some particular strengths in comparison to the other system. And many more questions like that. So therefore, then there was a need for error analysis and classification. So to distinguish several error categories and then see how many of them are present in the machine translation output. And then first of all, somewhere in 2006, the human error analysis started. And it's still widely used in the community, but then as any other human evaluation is resource intensive and time consuming. So therefore then there was a need to some automatic error analysis. So then I will present, there are also some other directions, but I will present my work from the beginning of this automatic method until now. So then first we wanted to achieve two goals. So first to see, for example, you have one translation output and then to see how many different error types are distributed, which is the most prominent error or most prominent error categories. And then on the other side, you want to compare different translation outputs and then see, this is better in the sense of, for example, missing words, or this is worse in the sense of terminology or whatever. So then we try, so of course, automatic error analysis so far cannot produce so many details as human analysis, for example, function words to distinguish terminology and simple mistranslation and many style and many other things. But then we use the scheme proposed by Villar in 2006, and we try to simplify to enable the automatic tool to distinguish them good. So they're basically inflection errors, so they're kind of morphology, but not all morphology, just inflection. So for example, the tense of the verb, if it's wrong, or plural, singular, or such things. Then reordering errors, so basically word order, if it's wrong. Then missing words, which you heard about also in speech recognition for the last talk. Then extra words, sometimes the translation system, they are adding extra words. And incorrect lexical choice. And then, so for those that may maybe not so acquainted with the field, so the speech recognition evaluation is straightforward. You have this VR, and then you have missing words, extra words, or substitutions. But of course, evaluation of translation is not so easy because there are many, many good translations, and also many manners to get something wrong. So that's why this is very broad research area also. So then, as I said, so we try to distinguish these five categories. Then using also VR at a distance, and then PR, this is position independent error rate, which is then, it looks only if the word is present both in reference and hypothesis, but not really how they are positioned. And then if you want to know something more about and details and mathematical formulas and every details, you have our work in computation linguistics, so towards automatic error analysis and machine translation output. So then, you use this elementary distance and PR, and then after you identified actual words which are affected, then you can define those five classes. Like for example, inflection error is then full form of the word is not okay, but base form is okay. So it meant that something went wrong with the word form. Then reordering error is then VR, so word error rate, elementary distance. There is an error, but just this PR, let's say, so the words are present both in the output and the reference translation, but something is wrong with the order. And then missing words is not just simply VR deletion because it's not so reliable, but then additionally it should be also, let's say, a reference PR error. So it's not in the reference and also it's VR deletion. And extra words the other way around. So this is VR insertion, which is also error in the output. And then the lexical error is basically when you discard all of this. So what stays is then lexical choice, substitution, if it's maybe easier. Okay, so this is some examples. So I show some colors, maybe to make it easier. So word order is green, inflection is pink, lexical is red, and missing words are blue. Then if you have a reference translation and empty output, I guess you see what happens. So there are these many green things in the first sentence. And then this designated assistance or some wrong lexical choice, wrong translations. And then in the other one, you can see, of course, that the method is strict. So basically, those blue things are not really errors, so as well in two. But because you're relying on the reference translation, that's in general a problem with the relying on the reference translation. It detected it as extra word or one extra word and one missing word, but it's okay. And then the other one is really missing words, so most beautiful, and there is also some inflection. So it should be in plural, but the translation system translated it into singular. And then if anybody wants to play with this, so there is also a tool. So open source tool, and it's published in Prague Bulletin for Mathematical Linguistics in 2011. It's called Hearson, and you can also download it. I put it the link, so you can use it. So it also provides a HTML output. It provides many outputs, but also this colored HTML output. And then when we started with this, then we also wanted to see, so does it correlate? So it looks, everything looks very nice, but does it really correlate with the human error analysis? Then we did a bunch of experiments, and as you can see, there is a bunch of numbers. I won't bother you too much, but just the point is that you can see that it works. So the correlations are rather high. And the worst correlations is 0.55 or 54, yeah, for some of the outputs. So they're all outputs that we analyzed. So this is error classes in one translation output. And then for those outputs left, they were really parallel. So we could also do the correlations across the translation outputs of each error category. And you can see that the correlations are also high, except for extra words. So this category seems to be still problematic, so we should work on it to make it more reliable. And then to understand a little bit more what happened, so we did some precisions and recalls and confusions, and then all in all also a bunch of numbers, but then the most important thing is that for the extra words there is a very low number. And they're often confused with a lexical error. So also missing an extra word are also confused with the lexical errors. And so a number of these extra words is either not that very, very frequent, for example, prepositions or articles, something, is either not detected because it appears all the time and then somehow you missed what really happened, or are tagged as reordering errors instead of missing words. But then recalls for all. So recalls are on the left, so they are more or less high for each error category except for experts. So all in all, after all these experiments, then we concluded, okay, we have a systematic method for automatic error classification. It works well. It's high correlations with human classification, high recall values except extra words. And it can replace or facilitate human error analysis. And then there were some recent experiments. If you calculate VR on base forms, you can then improve because then it's more stable if you do at a distance on base form, especially for more inflected languages. So it works. And then what we do with that? So first, application. So you analyze your empty system. Then you have, so in this case, it's statistical phrase-based system. So I did my PhD in statistical, so yeah, most of these results are statistical. So you have some German-English translation, and then you count the errors. So you say, aha, okay. So in my system, the most problematic are lexical errors, but then ordering and missing words is also very bad, yeah? And then you can think about, can I do something about it? Maybe try to improve this. And then you can attack reordering errors. And then you can do it in two ways. So you can apply some pre-reordering of verbs. So these verbs that are at the end, you push it more forward to make German which looks more like English. So then you can some output V and 2, which I will show later. Or maybe use a hierarchical phrase-based system. So this system then takes care also of these reorderings and gaps inside. And so on, and then see what happens. And then what happened? So now we apply, so the other application is comparing empty systems. But then for this, I have to say that it's not very wise to use row counts, but you have to normalize over all number of words, because if some output has less words, it's not then really fair. So then you obtain basically error rates. So inflectional error rate, ordering error rate, and so on and so on. And then you can see that you improved by this verb reordering. You actually really, so you're, I don't have any blue scores or whatever, but it's improved, yes. But then you can really see that you improved, really, the orderings. And also, you improve lexical errors somehow implicitly. And then by hierarchical system, you reduce significantly missing words. Because, for example, with this German problem, you have also sometimes problem that the verb is missing because it's so far away at the end, and then translation system somehow forgets about that and doesn't produce them. And also implicitly lexical error. So I have just to say this was very old version of hierarchical system, I don't know, 5 years ago or something. So now, so it didn't improve reordering errors, it's actually increased, but nowadays the hierarchical system also improved the reordering errors. Good, so now, what we do now, so it was in the past, and then what we are applying now, so the other application is then you can involve some human translators and, for example, analyze their post-edits. So there are a bunch of post-edits data nowadays, and then if you want to know what the people actually did, you can apply this program, and then you use this post-edited translation output as reference translation, and then you see this. So as you can see, there are less errors, of course, because if you use some independent reference translation, which is far away, then it induces more error. But here is then really captured what the people changed. So really added distance, kind of, yeah. And then on the first example, there are reordering and inflectional and lexical error. So in the other, there are really some missing extra words. And on the last one is one lexical edit, let's say, and one inflection is corrected. So then one of the applications of those analysis of post-edits is then, for example, sometimes the human translations are given several translation outputs for one source sentence, and then they should post-edit it, and they selected one, which is easiest for them to post-edit. And then the question is there some edit operations which maybe make this more difficult or that they don't want to choose. So we try to do these edit rates on selected sentences and then on the not selected sentences, the rest. And then relative difference, so it's always, of course, it's always high, much more editing in the rest, which is expected. But it looks that on the first sight, so this is a very rough experiment, but the first sight looks that the difference is largest for the missing words. So it indicates that this is not particularly preferred edit operation, but it should be, in order to drive any really big conclusions, there should be some future work because it's only at the start, and then you should analyze also part of speech and maybe positions and so many things. And then the other interesting thing, what we tried to see, for example, is those four or five systems. So one is best ranked. So you say, okay, this is the best translation, I want to use it already. But then if you select it for post-editing, it might not be necessarily the best rank. So in the 70%, it is best rank, but in 30%, it's not. And we wanted to see if then simply edit the distance then is the main thing. So, for example, if you select something which is not the best, the edit distance is really less. So this is the sum of all these edits, inflectional, others. But then for German and Spanish, it's not, it's very similar. But there were some type of data which we should analyze further. And then for English German, it's actually much higher in the selected sentences, which are not the best. But then this is really worth a future work, because English German is anyway very, let's say, interesting translation direction. So for statistical and for rule based and for all the system. I mean, most difficult. Yeah. Okay, so now we have also a big project. So this is called Qt Launchpad, and here we can see the details. And so what is part of this project? So basically, the translation quality is the main point of this project. So how to get the high quality translations. And then what we did with this analysis of post-edit, so there are different quality levels when you get some translation output, and then there are also data that the people classified those outputs. It's, for example, easy to post-edit, so I'll explain that. And then what are the differences between, so the estimated translation quality and then really performed post-edits. And then there are five, in the data that we analyzed, there are five quality levels. So one is already accepted, so translation is already okay. I don't have to do anything. Then the next level is almost acceptable. I have to edit something, but not much. Then it's possible to edit, so I can repair it. Yeah, it costs me, but it's okay. The next is okay. It's bad, but it's still possible to edit. Still better than I start all over. And then the last one is very low clarity, so it's really better to translate from scratch. And then knowing this, then we obtained. Okay, so just a few words about data. So those are. Data translated was statistical systems, and they're English to Spanish and French to English. So you can see also from number of sentences, there are most of the translation outputs are this in the middle ground. So you can edit it either very easy or not so easy. But then these really bad and really good translations, there are not so much of them. And then you obtain some nice graphs. So these are those five classes, so form of the word, inflection, order, missing, or lexical. And these are quality levels. And then, of course, for the good sentences, so some people still prefer some edits in the good sentence, but OK. So there are very few edit operations. And then the number of the edit operation grows. But what is interesting is that the order operation grow, and the lexical operation grows significantly. And then if you say all the three sets of data, so same happens. So this is English-Spanish, and then for French to English, the only difference is actually that there are less morphological errors, which is also clear, you know, because Spanish has a richer morphology. And so then based on all of this, so there is some multi-dimensional quality metric which we introduced in the Qt Launcher project, which aims to put together also the machine translation errors and human translation errors and to put all them together. So I don't want now to go into too much detail, so there is only a hierarchy, but some of them are possible also to map to our five classes. So as I said, this is human error notation, of course, because it's not so easy to check the style and some of things here, function words, still, maybe in the future. We can introduce more categories into automatic tool, but still not all of them. But anyway, there are some mappings which are clear. So this is equivalent choice. For example, terminology mistranslation is a lexical choice. Omission is clear, missing word, and addition extra word. And agreement is actually inflection. So it should be singular, should be plural, and so on and so on. Word order is clearly word order. And then we made some very preliminary results on some small German-English corpus. And then first, for example, okay, so I try to put this, yeah, okay. So here is the, so the two rule-based system and two statistical systems, and then most prominent errors were counted, and then my colleague did this very nice graph. And then you can see that, for example, in rule-based system, there are much more terminology errors, and then grammar is a little bit better handled than in statistical, but not significantly better. And omission is handled much better in rule-based system than in statistical system. And then if you apply our automatic tool on the same data, you can, of course, obtain only 5 categories, but then so some tendencies, not all of them, but some tendencies you can also spot immediately like this. So for example, this for missing words is very clear that SMT systems, statistical systems are worse. And then also word order inflection are slightly better in RBMT. And then lexical is worse in, lexical errors are a little bit worse in rule-based systems. And so, summary, so those results are then what is interesting about these results. So they are stable for all 3 data sets. As I said, the graphs are the same, so no crossing, and the lexical and word order errors increase when quality decreases for all data sets. And then our automatic analysis of editize also correlates with rough MQM, so multidimensional quality results. And all this offers a number of possible directions for a future word. So then, as I said, this work has been partly supported with our project, Qt Launchpad, and I want to say many thanks to our professor Hans Suskreit and my colleague Aril Omel, because without them, the project would not be possible. So thanks. Some other outputs, you can say, aha, word order, and then maybe repair it very easily, but repair something else. And there was also some strange stuff in German and Spanish, but it's also due to the data. So if you put away some part of the data, which should be also domain, I mean, if you put it away, then it's also that it is lower, then it's clear. But for English German, it's definitely the language pair, in the other direction. Mm-hmm.
What was the domain?
So there's a mixture of 3 domains, so news, client data for the language service providers, and open office. So those client data was in some language version more of them, less of them, and different. There were different, completely parallel, so that's why.